OMFS lecture series. The topic for this lecture is Ludwig's angina. Ludwig's angina is basically a type of severe cellulitis involving the floor of the mouth. It is a name given to a massive, firm, brawny cellulitis or induration and acute toxic stage involving simultaneously the submandibular, sublingual and submental spaces bilaterally. So this is the definition of Ludwig's angina. This condition was first described by Wilhelm Friedrich von Ludwig in the year 1836. So as the definition suggests, only the bilateral involvement of the above mentioned spaces is considered to be a classical disease of Ludwig's angina. All other types of presentations, though massive, are not considered as Ludwig's angina. The word angina is derived from the Latin word angere, meaning suffocation or choking sensation. And the word Ludwig comes from the person to whom the credit goes for its description. This condition has established its unique identity with three F's. As it was to be feared, it rarely becomes fluctuant, and it was often fatal. Many other terminologies were also used for this condition, which include Marbus strangulatorius. It is also called angina maligna and garrotilo. There are various causes attributed to Ludwig's angina. For example, odontogenic infection. These infections in the form of acute dentoalveolar abscess, acute periodontal abscess or acute pericoronal abscess. All these can lead to Ludwig's angina. As already told in the lecture on pterygomandibular space infection, pericoronal abscess in relation to erupting third molars can extend into sublingual, submandibular and pterygomandibular spaces, thus resulting in Ludwig's angina. Use of a contaminated needle for giving local anesthesia is an iatrogenic cause. Traumatic injuries to the orofacial region, like a compound and comminuted mandibular fractures or a deep penetrating wound, can also lead to this condition. Osteomyelitis secondary to compound mandibular fractures or an acute exacerbation of chronic osteomyelitis of mandible may develop into Ludwig's angina. Acute or chronic infections of salivary glands, for example sublingual and submandibular sialadenitis, are also causes of this condition. The malignancies of oral region. It can give rise to secondary infection, thus leading to this condition. The miscellaneous causes of Ludwig's angina include infections in the tonsils or pharyngeal area, foreign bodies such as fish bone or oral soft tissue lacerations. So this is regarding the etiology of Ludwig's angina. Here you need to understand that the condition of Ludwig's angina is a cellulitis, which is a diffuse inflammation of soft tissues, which is not circumscribed or confined to one area. But in contrast to the abscess, it tends to spread through tissue spaces and along facial planes. So such type of spreading infection occurs in the presence of organisms that produce significant amounts of hyaluronidase and fibrinolysins, which act to break down or dissolve the hyaluronic acid and fibrin. A plethora of microorganisms has been implicated as the causative agents of Ludwig's angina. Few of the microorganisms which were able to be isolated from the culture specimen include staphylococci, streptococci, E. coli, bacteroids, anaerobic streptococci, peptostreptococcus and fusospirochetes. The condition of Ludwig's angina usually follows a submandibular space infection, caused by a periapical infection or pericoronitis around the mandibular second and third molar. The apices of these teeth are usually placed below the mylohyoid line of mylohyoid muscle so that the infection tends to spread primarily to the submandibular spaces. The infection then spread to the sublingual space around the submandibular gland, which is present posterior to the space. The submental space is also involved by lymphatic spread. This condition can also occur in converse manner, that is by spread from the sublingual space to the submandibular space. The signs and symptoms of Ludwig's angina are present with varying degree of severity. Upon general examination, the patient looks toxic, very ill and dehydrated. There is pyrexia, anorexia, chills and malaise. There is dysphagia or difficulty in swallowing. The speech is impaired and there is hoarseness of voice. Upon extraoral examination, there is a firm, hard, browny swelling in the bilateral submandibular and submandibular regions, which may extend down to the anterior neck till the clavicle. There is severe muscle spasm, which may lead to trismus or restricted jaw movements. So here, typically the mouth remains open due to edema of the sublingual tissues, leading to raised tongue, which almost touches the palatal vault. There is airway obstruction and the respiratory rate may be seen to be raised, breathing being shallow with accessory muscles of respiration being used. Cyanosis may occur due to the progressive hypoxia. Ultimately, fatal death may occur in untreated case of Ludwig's angina within 10 to 24 hours due to asphyxia. Intraorally, the swelling develops rapidly, which involves the sublingual tissues and raises the floor of mouth. The tongue may be raised against the palate. There is increased salivation, stiffness of tongue movements and difficulty in swallowing. A backward spread of infection leads to edema of glottis, thus resulting in respiratory obstruction. Stridor is a harsh vibrating noise when breathing, which is caused by obstruction of trachea or larynx. Stridor is an alarming sign of Ludwig's angina, which needs emergency intervention to keep the airway patent. From the sublingual spaces, the infection may spread backwards towards the region of epiglottis. This produces swelling around the laryngeal inlet. Due to anatomical continuity of various spaces with submandibular space, the infection may spread posteriorly to the mesenteric spaces and the parapharyngeal spaces, thus worsening the airway compromise. Infection from the submandibular region can also spread downwards beneath the investing layer of deep cervical fascia towards the clavicle and towards the mediastinum, thus causing mediastinitis. Less commonly, infection can spread below towards the carotid sheath also, which leads to cavernous sinus thrombosis with subsequent meningitis. Ludwig's angina, if untreated, can be fatal within 12 to 24 hours, death arising from asphyxia. The cases may become more complicated with involvement of other spaces. Therefore, the condition should be taken as a life-threatening emergency situation and is best treated by aggressive intervention. The treatment is based on the combination of the following factors: early diagnosis, maintenance of patent airway, intense and prolonged antibiotic therapy, extraction of offending teeth, and surgical drainage or decompression of facial spaces. Surgical drainage or decompression is performed under general anesthesia given to the patient by a skilled anesthesiologist. An awake endotracheal intubation is performed using fiber optic laryngoscope and nasopharyngeal airway is maintained. In case of Ludwig's angina, the death can occur from asphyxia rather than the infection itself. Hence, it is advisable to observe the patient for respiratory obstruction and restlessness. Blind intubation should be always avoided. Nasoendotracheal intubation is far more reliable and it is almost predictable. Therefore, it is preferred. Surgical airway may be required in case of severe upper respiratory obstruction. Laryngotomy or cricothyroidectomy is preferred over tracheostomy, considering the complications associated with tracheostomy. The surgical intervention has two main aims: to remove the cause and surgical decompression. The advantages of early surgical decompression include the following. It reduces the pressure of edematous tissue on the airway, thus reducing respiratory obstruction. It allows prompt drainage if any suppuration develops. It also allows obtaining specimen or samples for staining and culture and sensitivity. It allows placement of drains, which may be useful to drain the pus collection. And also it helps in irrigation of the tissues at regular intervals. Antibiotics play a vital role in managing Ludwig's angina. Usually, IV antibiotics with proper dosage and frequency are necessary. Penicillins are the first line of antibiotics in treating Ludwig's angina, as it is a broad-spectrum antibiotic. Semi-synthetic derivatives of penicillin like ampicillin or amoxicillin may be also used. In case of allergy to penicillin, the patient is administered erythromycin. Antibiotics should be changed subsequent to the result of bacterial culture and sensitivity testing. The therapy should also be changed if the favorable results are not observed after 48 to 72 hours of therapy. Most cases of Ludwig's angina are dehydrated. This is because of two reasons: diminished liquid intake due to pain and discomfort associated with dysphagia. So, due to the toxic nature of the condition, there is usually excessive urination and perspiration, which further diminishes body fluids. For these reasons, patients should be encouraged to have liquids frequently, and if required, intravenously, fluids can maintain hydration and also calories. A simple protocol for the management of Ludwig's angina include a pre, peri and post-operative protocol. Pre-operative airway assessment includes observing the signs and symptoms of obstruction. Thoroughly examine the mouth opening, the tongue mobility, the region of uvula and facial pillars. Confirm the etiological findings using an orthopantomogram or a CT scan of head and neck. Consider the risk factors like diabetes and immunodeficiency. Check if the patient is well hydrated by monitoring the BP, pulse and urine output. Check the temperature, assess the blood and urine cultures for septicemia. Apply cold packs and use antipyretics as required. Obtain chest radiographs to rule out pneumonia. Evaluate the lab data for blood count and protein levels, and also consider emergency airway preparations. The perioperative protocol includes intubation, removal of the cause and surgical drainage, and appropriate antibiotics. The postoperative considerations include extubation after confirming an adequate airway, periodic irrigation of the drains, obtaining culture reports to adjust the antibiotics accordingly, reevaluation of lab reports, monitoring the course of infection, and re-exploration and drainage if necessary, and finally following up the patient regularly. Ludwig's angina continues to be a cause of significant morbidity and mortalities. The various complications associated with Ludwig's angina are osteomyelitis, maxillary sinusitis, localized respiratory tract disturbances, as well as digestive tract disturbances. Even more serious complications include life-threatening airway obstruction, septicemia, distant metastatic focus, mediastinitis, pericarditis, internal jugular vein thrombosis, several neurological complications, involvement of carotid sheath, and ultimately death. Talking a little more about mediastinitis, the mediastinum is the central portion of the thorax. It is bounded bilaterally by the pleura, ventrally by the sternum, dorsally by the vertebrae, and inferiorly by the diaphragm. Vital structures located within the mediastinum include the heart, the aortic arch, the lungs, carotid and subclavian arteries, the thoracic duct, vagus nerve, the trachea and esophagus. Therefore, odontogenic infection spreading to the mediastinum is a life-threatening complication, and it should be suspected in the patient who exhibits exacerbation of fever associated with substernal pain. Therefore, mediastinitis is an infection involving the connective mediastinal tissue that fills the interpleural space and surrounds the median thoracic organs. The chest X-ray will show typical widening of the mediastinum. There is also pleural effusion and obliteration of sternal spaces. Treatment includes early recognition, airway management, and aggressive surgical intervention. Appropriate antibiotic therapy should be followed along with supportive systemic care and hyperbaric oxygen therapy whenever indicated. Hence, to conclude, Ludwig's angina is a life-threatening complication associated with orofacial infections, which can become fatal if not timely diagnosed and intervened. That's all for this lecture. Thank you.